Winds are the result of differences in air pressure. This means any time you feel winds, and we have all felt them, what you are experiencing is differences in air pressure within the atmosphere. Air flows from areas of high pressure to areas of low pressure. That is what you will experience as wind, the air going from high pressure to low pressure. It never goes the other way. It's never going to go from low pressure to high pressure. I don't know how you would memorize this, but perhaps you want to look at it like water. Water flows from the high area downslope to the low area. Now, this has nothing whatsoever to do with wind or air movement, but the words are the same, high and low. So air is always going to go from areas of high pressure to areas of low pressure. That's what we experience as winds. Take a look at this diagram. On the left-hand side, we have an anticyclonic system, high pressure. What you see happening with the red arrows is the air is descending and diverging, as it always does in high pressure. If this was the northern hemisphere, the air would be circulating clockwise and out, right? Right. Now look at the right-hand side. We have a cyclonic system, a cyclone, low pressure. With low pressure, the air converges and rises like it does everywhere on Earth with low pressure. But if this was the northern hemisphere, the air would be circulating counterclockwise and in. If you happen to find yourself between those two pressure systems, as the air flows from high to low, don't you know that's the way it's going to go? You would be experiencing wind. If you're right below the high pressure, probably you're not going to experience wind because the air is moving vertically, not horizontally. And if you were right below the low pressure system, you may not be experiencing wind either there because the air is moving vertically, not horizontally. How big of an area is this? Well, in truth, it could be as big as the college campus and it could be as big as the United States. High and low pressure systems come in all sorts of shapes and sizes. Winds are named by the direction they come from, not the direction they go to. Keep that in mind. We know where they came from because that's a past event. Therefore, if the air is blowing from north to south, we call that wind a northerly. If the wind is blowing from south to north, we call that wind a southerly. Now you can sing along with me. If the wind is blowing from west to east, that's a westerly. And if the wind is blowing from east to west, that's an easterly. What about if the wind is blowing from northeast to southwest? That would be a northeasterly wind. Very good. There's going to be a very important northeasterly wind coming up in a future lesson. Keep that in mind, I just told you. Winds flow from high to low across a pressure gradient. Pressure gradients indicate the rate and direction of wind flow. Rate means velocity. It doesn't tell you the wind is blowing 37 miles an hour. But it does give you an indication of whether the wind is moving rapidly or slowly. And it also tells you the general direction of wind flow. In other words, is it a northerly wind? Is it an easterly wind? Do you remember isobars? At the end of the first section of this class, we had those four words that started with iso. Iso in Greek means line. We had isopleths. That was the generic term. It meant any line on a map that connects points of equal value, like for example, lines of latitude are isopleths, types of isopleths. We had isotherms. Do you remember what they did? They connected points of equal temperature. We had isohyets. How about that one? Connected points of equal precipitation. And isobars. These connect points of equal atmospheric pressure. Now you can see where the term comes from. Barometer. Barometric pressure, right? We already saw this map one time before. Now let's take a little closer look at it. There are isobars indicating equal pressure on this map. Right in the middle of the map, more or less, in the southeastern corner of Colorado, you can see that L. You now know that that L means low pressure. And with low pressure, the air is converging, rising, making clouds, and probably precipitation. Therefore, if you are in southeastern Colorado when this is happening, you're probably getting precipitation. Now notice the isobars going around the L. These are in millibars. Remember, 1013 millibars is average pressure at sea level, which is the same as 14.7 pounds per square inch or 29.92 inches of mercury. But this is in millibars, which is the most common way it's depicted. Now notice, the first ring going around the L is 996 millibars, the 1,000, the 1,004, the 1,008, the 1,012, the 1,016, 1,020, 1,024, and so on. So it's every 4 millibars, okay? Very good. Before we go any further, take a close look at this map and notice, as you go north of Colorado, so into Nebraska, South Dakota, North Dakota, or Wyoming, and into Montana, notice that the isobars are very close together. Whereas as you go south into Texas, notice that they're spread apart significantly more. And then notice at the top of the map, you can see where it says 1,032 and 1,028, 1,024. That would be a higher pressure area. The winds would be flowing from the high pressure area toward the low pressure area. I just circled the low pressure for you. Now I circled the high pressure areas for you. And remember, the air is going to flow from high to low. So first, take a look at these two arrows. Notice the arrow on the right-hand side. If you were in northeastern Colorado, if that indicates wind flow as the air is going from high to low, you would be getting northerly or northeasterly winds. And if you were in the northwestern corner of Colorado, you would be getting a northwesterly wind. At the same time, I want you to look at this. I told you that those isobars are very close together north of that L, that low pressure system. When the isobars are very close together, we call this a steep or a strong pressure gradient. Both of those words are fine to use. It's probably 50-50. Half the time it's steep pressure gradient, half the time it's strong pressure gradient. They mean the same thing. And what that means is the following. When you have a steep or strong pressure gradient, that means that the isobars are close together. It indicates a rapid change in pressure over distance. So in other words, you're going from high pressure to low pressure quickly, and it results in high velocity winds. So now you know, if you were in northeastern Colorado, not only would you have a north-northeasterly wind, but the winds would be high velocity. Okay, take a look here now at these arrows. Let's look at first the one that's south of the L, so south of Colorado in Texas. Notice that the isobars are spread much further apart. If you were in that area of northern Texas, you would be getting a southerly wind. Now notice over the top of the Great Lakes, you can see that the isobars are also spread far apart there. Okay? When the isobars are spread far apart, we have what's known as a weak or shallow pressure gradient. Again, weak and shallow are interchangeable. They're probably used 50% of the time each one. Weak pressure gradient, shallow pressure gradient. That means this. The isobars are spread far apart, which indicates a gradual change in pressure over distance. That means that you're going from high to low, but not rapidly. And weak or shallow pressure gradients result in low velocity winds.